Okay, can I get my slides up? And Valerie, I put a break point in my talk, so if I'm running over, rather than have the wrath of Valerie Lund, just say cut it off and I'll stop it halfway through. So I'm going to I changed the title of my talk slightly because this had to do with novel therapies as well, and I'm going to talk about the role of taste receptors in as a biomarker for predicting outcomes in chronic sinusitis and then possible novel targets for therapy. So these are my disclosures, if I can move my slide. The only thing that's really relevant is this patent that's still pending that I'll talk to some of the data on that. So as an introduction, humans have about 25 genes that encode 25 different bitter taste receptors. These are G protein coupled receptors. There is tremendous genetic variability in these 25, in this subfamily of G protein coupled receptors. As a matter of fact, there are 89 common polymorphisms that are found within 5% of the population or greater. And because these are intronless genes, each one of these polymorphisms has a functional consequence. In addition to being expressed in the tongue, in the last 10 years, these taste receptors have been found all over our body, mostly at the mucosal barriers. Anywhere that our body comes in contact with bacteria, these taste receptors are expressed. So they're in your GU system, they're in your GI system, they're in the respiratory system. In addition to detecting molecules that taste bitter, what we demonstrated over the last 5 years is that products that bacteria secrete are also agonists for these bitter taste receptors. And the work that came out of our lab over the last 6 years demonstrated that these taste receptors in the sinonasal epithelium regulate two local immediate pathways. And I'm going to go over them in the next two slides. So the first pathway that is regulated by taste receptors are taste receptors that are expressed in the ciliated cells. And in these cells, they detect molecules, bitter molecules of bacteria secrete. When activated, they get you get a small rise in intracellular calcium, which activates NOS. The cell produces NO, which diffuses out into the airway, and you get the bactericidal concentrations. In addition to it diffusing out into the airway, the nitric oxide activates protein kinase G and increases mucociliary clearance so that these dead and lice bacteria are cleared out of the airway and are not even inflammatory. So this is one pathway of immediate innate immunity regulated by bitter taste receptors. And there is another one in a discrete cell type known as a solitary chemosensory cell, which is not really well known. It is in the native state found in about 1 in 400 cells. These are non-ciliated cells. They almost look like neuroendocrine cells. And these cells express bitter taste receptors as well. There is a different repertoire of the 25 taste receptors, so it looks like it's mutually exclusive. If there are taste receptors on the ciliated cell, those same receptors will not be expressed on the ciliated cell, on the solitary chemosensory cell. When these taste receptors are activated by different bitter molecules that the bacteria secrete, you get a rise in intracellular calcium. It propagates to the surrounding cells where you get a release of antimicrobial peptides, where it becomes locally in a clearing of the bacteria in that immediate environment. So as I mentioned to you, there's tremendous genetic variability in people's ability to taste different bitter molecules. The best studied is to a compound known as phenylthiocarbamide, which has been known for about 100 years. In the Northern European population, in the Caucasian population, approximately 20% of the population detects it at incredibly small concentrations. These are known as super tasters. About 30% of the population doesn't detect it at all, and 50% are somewhere in the middle. So this follows classic Mendelian genetics, right? And so based on the ability to taste this molecule, a publication was put out by a group at the NIH in 2003, which found the receptor to PTC. They called it bitter taste receptor T2R38. And what they showed that in this gene, there were three polymorphisms at these three positions. If you had a proline, alanine, or valine, that receptor functioned and you tasted PTC. If you had an alanine, valine, or isoleucine, that receptor did not function. 85% of the time, these three amino acids segregate together. And what's interesting is depending on your heritage, the predominance of the functional versus non-functional difference differs. So in the Caucasian population, it's a balanced polymorphism. Nearly 50% of the alleles are non-functional, 50% are functional. In Asians, it's 70-30, and in Africans, it's 90-10. So if you have two haplotypes, that basically generates three genotypes. You're either homozygote functional or PAV-PAV, and these are the individuals that can taste PTC. You're homozygote non-functional, and these are the individuals that don't taste PTC, or you're somewhere in the middle. And then what I also want to stress is that we demonstrated that T2R38 also detects the quorum-sensing molecules that gram-negative bacteria secrete. So in addition to PTC, this molecule tastes things like Pseudomonas, okay? So in this experiment, what we did is we took cells, nasal cells, from our three different genotypes. So we either had patients that were supertasters, patients that were non-tasters, or heterozygotes, and we loaded those cells up with a molecule called DAF-FM. This is an intracellular dye that fluoresces when the cell starts making nitric oxide. And here we started stimulating and increasing concentrations of these bitter molecules that the gram-negatives make. This is C12-HSL, it's a homoserine lactone. This is C4-HSL, and the x-axis is your time. So you can see that within about 2 to 5 minutes of throwing on a very low concentration of these quorum-sensing molecules, patients that are supertasters start producing nitric oxide at very, very low concentrations, whereas the non-tasters, you barely get a bump even at higher concentrations. So the model that we build from that one piece of data is the following. If you are a homozygote dominant, if you're PAV-PAV, gram-negative bacteria come into your nose, they make these quorum-sensing molecules, it's detected by this bitter taste receptor expressed in the cilia, you get this small rise in intracellular calcium, you activate ENOS, you start making nitric oxide, it increases ciliary beat frequency, and it diffuses out into the airway where it kills the bacteria. As opposed, if you don't taste PTC and you are a non-taster, the same bacteria come into your nose, they secrete these quorum-sensing molecules, it's a non-functional receptor, nothing happens, and you're screwed and you get biofilms. That's at least the model that we generate off of our in vitro data. So does this translate to any of our clinical data? So we went back and we looked at all the patients that we were operating on that we had genotyped already, and we looked at the microbiology reports coming from these patients. And like many of you, we do a lot of non-CRS rhinologic surgery, a lot of pituitary surgery. So we had a lot of patients with normal noses that we were operating on. And we had already genotyped them for T2R38. We genotyped them for three other bitter taste receptors that have the near same minor allele frequency, so the same amount of functional and non-functional alleles. And we binned our microbiology into either normal growth or no growth, or gram negatives. And the caveat to this data is that we ignored the gram positives. So we looked at patients that either harbored gram negatives or had normal growth or no growth, but we didn't go after the Staph aureus. And this is what we saw. In the patients that had no growth, we saw an equal distribution between the three different genotypes. But in the patients that harbored gram negatives, we didn't find a single patient that was a supertaster that had gram negatives in their nose. And this was in a fairly small study. This was 56 patients, and you can see what our p-value is. So with regard to the specific question of T2R38 genetics and gram-negative infections, we had a very, very strong effect. So what about outcomes? Okay, so we looked at 123 patients that we did primary FES at Penn with, and we looked at their six-month follow-up, and we were looking at their delta SNOT. To have a clinically significant improvement in your quality of life, you need around 9 points change. So overall, these 123 patients were doing pretty well. They had a 25-point improvement. If we break up these outcomes on the basis of their T2R38 genotype, not much to get too excited about. Maybe our supertasters do slightly better with a 30-point improvement compared to 24 points, but again, not statistically significant. One of the things that has been hammered in over the last couple lectures is that sinusitis comes in two different flavors, pun intended. You have either a TH1 or a TH2. Now, if we break up those 123 patients on whether they were having surgery for polyps or for more of this purulent biofilm-like disease, this is what you see. So in our polyp patients, we had pretty good outcomes. Whether you were a taster or a non-taster, you had nearly a 30-point improvement at 6 months. These patients were pretty happy that they had their surgery. But if you look at the non-polyp patients, this is where we see a stark contrast. We didn't operate on that many patients that don't have polyps that were non-tasters, number one, so it was rare for us to operate on these patients that are supertasters for that polypoid purulent type of disease. And it was the non-tasters that barely had clinically significant improvement at 6 months. So the question that we're asking now is, what do you do for these patients? Are these the patients that go for big hole surgery? Do you treat them more like a CF patient where you do gravity-dependent surgery, mega enterostomies, maybe a draft three? Or maybe these patients don't really need to be going to surgery. Maybe we don't have a good surgical option for them. But these are the patients that we keep doing revision after revision after revision. And even though they have wide open cavities and you could drive a truck in there, they're not getting better because it's not an anatomic problem. It's a mucosal or innate immunity problem. So I kind of started touching on these ideas of biofilms. And over the last 15 years, we've become aware that biofilms really in that non-polypoid disease are difficult to treat patients. These are our recalcitrant patients. They require additional steroids and medical therapy. They have persistent inflammation. They have higher rates of revision. And so what we wanted to know is, does T2R38 really contribute to forming biofilms? So this was a fairly simple study that we did with a medical student who was rotating through the lab, and he basically sat in our clinic and collected microbiologic swabs from consecutive patients that came into the clinic. And we did an ex vivo, and I stress that this isn't biofilms in vivo, it's ex vivo. We took these swabs back to the lab, and we grew them up with a bunch of controls, and you basically let the bacteria adhere to a plastic plate. The amount of slime that adheres to the plate is really the biofilm matrix. So you let them go for about 20 hours, you shake them out, you then fix them and you stain with crystal violet, and the amount of crystal violet that stains the plate correlates to the amount of biofilm that got deposited. Okay, and then you just simply read it at OD595. So the controls that we used here, we used some store-bought Pseudomonas, here's a wild type, and two mutants that don't form biofilms, and here you can see the crystal violet staining for that biofilm compared to these two. And in 59 consecutive patients, on the y-axis here is biofilm, and these are the different patients. You can see that some patients form really robust biofilms, some patients hardly form biofilms. All these patients, we genotyped for T2R38, and this is what we saw. So in the context of the functionality of T2R38, the non-tasters tended to form more biofilms than the super-tasters. But this was not significant. So we thought, is there a better way to gauge the function of T2R38? Instead of looking at genotype, could we look at the phenotype? So could we ask these patients to taste different bitter molecules? How bitter the molecule tastes on their tongue would tell us how much of that functional allele they have. And so working with a group over at Manel, we developed a very easy to administer test in the clinic. It takes about 5 minutes, where they taste PTC, which is bitter, sucrose, which is sweet, water, a couple more bitter molecules, and salt. And this is what we saw in the context. So on the x-axis, this is the more bitter the molecule tastes, and they don't taste it at all, and this is our biofilm. So you can see that there is a statistically significant correlation between PTC taste in the tongue and ex vivo biofilm formation. What we learned from our outcomes in the surgery is that the effect appears to be in the non-polyp patients. So if we break it up into the patients, whether they had polyps or non-polyps, we can see that the entire effect is being driven by our non-polyp patients with a very, very significant correlation and absolutely no correlation in our polyp patients. And if we look at any of the other things that the patients tasted, so here's salt for the non-polyp or all patients, or quinine, another bitter molecule, no correlation at all. So it looks like at least taste sensitivity to PTC is somewhat predictive of biofilm formation ex vivo. So what I've shown you so far is that this is a biomarker, it's a genetic biomarker, but we also have a phenotype that can be tested in the clinic, and that it basically correlates the susceptibility to gram-negative sinus infections, ex vivo biofilm formation, and poor surgical outcomes. Now, I can stop there, and we can move on, or I can talk about the second half. Am I cutting off? Fine, let me get to my last section. I'm not even going to talk about the therapies. So basically, that's it. That was my conclusion slide, and I won't talk about therapeutics. Let's go back to I'll take any questions. Okay, sorry.